Hallo von.
Willkommen hier in Eliza für den dritten Talk dieses Blogs an diesem zweiten Tage hier. Uns wird heute Rainer Rehak etwas über was schützt eigentlich der Datenschutz erzählen. Und er wird uns eine kleine Einführung mit einem strukturellen Blick auf den Datenschutz gewähren.
So this evening's talk is about Rainer Rehak. It's what's going to protect the privacy or what's going to protect data protection. Rainer Rehak is member of the FIF. That's the Forum Computer Specialists for Peace and Social Responsibility.
Ja, was schützt eigentlich der Datenschutz? Ich bin sehr froh, hier sprechen zu dürfen.
So what's what is protecting data protection?
Warum Datenschützerin aufhören müssen, von individueller Privatheit zu sprechen? Das ist ja immer so.
So why do data protection officers have to stop talking about privacy, individual privacy? So it's about the inner stuff, about so this is quite short.
Die wir eigentlich mit der Argumentation sozusagen bekämpfen wollen oder überzeugen.
So it's actually coming too short. We would like to have a broader view on the whole subject. So something about me, myself.
Dass man so ein bisschen einsortieren kann, inhaltlich. Also ich bin selber wissenschaftlicher Mitarbeiter am Weizenbaum-Institut für die vernetzte Gesellschaft.
I'm assistant to the Weizenbaum Institute for Interconnected Society. My special interest is in information security, data protection. I studied in computer sciences and philosophies. And the Chinese University of Hong Kong and the Humboldt University in Berlin. And my master's thesis was about online searching. So I'm member of the FIF and two more. So some of you would like to point out some general notions, the problem that we would like to discuss in data protection theory and operationalization. So how to get concrete hands-on information on from the theories.
Nicht-Lösungen sagen.
What are non-solutions?
Vielleicht, wenn sich da Fragen anschließen, werden wir auch eine Q&A noch machen, dass wir das diskutieren können zusammen. Dann werde ich ein Fazit präsentieren und dann kommt noch ein.
Hopefully we can also discuss those non-solutions in the discussion afterwards. And there will be a resume and also some hints on literature and forums in the end.
Also erstmal die Begriffe. Erstmal,
some
wenn man über Datenschutz redet, im Englischen
definitions. So in English it's even more complicated. There's privacy and data protection. So it's some mix of definitions or notions.
Erstens, Datenschutz selber ist ein soziales.
So data protection itself is a social definition or social notion.
Datenschutzrecht ist ein juristischer Begriff.
Und data protection legislation is as a juristic notion and also data security as a notion of computer sciences. But all have their own rules of discourse and together with the description of the problem there is also a solution. It's a solution of its own, but they are all interconnected.
Und naja, es ist, wie bei allem ist es so, dass die Problembeschreibung selber auch die Lösung so ein bisschen vordefiniert. Das heißt, der Korridor, wo man hinschaut, was da.
So it's important to know what notion is being used of this privacy or data protection or notion of information.
Die muss beantwortet werden. Jetzt mal kurz als Überflug.
So, some overview on the legislation on data protection. So, it's protecting individuals. It's personal data.
Weitläufig diskutiert. Und zum Beispiel die Begründung, was schützt eigentlich die Datenschutzgrundverordnung?
So, the General Data Protection Regulation, GDPR. Is protecting Article 8, that's protecting individual information or individual data, personal data.
Der EU, zum Beispiel als Vergleich mal mit
so, if you would like, it's like the constitution of the European Union. It's Article 1 is the base of it all. So the
Schutzpersonenbezogener Daten, das steht da eigentlich genauso drin. Und wenn der Schutz personenbezogener Daten ein Grundrecht ist auf europäischer Ebene,
so it's a basic law.
Verarbeitung dann auch eine Verletzung von Grundrechten ist. Wobei die Frage dann bleibt, ja, aber warum eigentlich? Also wenn man so ein bisschen vorrechtlich diskutieren will, ist jetzt, wenn man sagt, na, wir schützen personenbezogene Daten, warum? Naja,
so,
weil wir ein Recht auf Schutz personenbezogener Daten haben, ist richtig.
Actually, it shouldn't be a circle like we are protecting personal data. Why? Because it's a basic law to protect personal data. That sounds a little funny, but actually it has to be put back to Article 1. So data security, this is about
Schutzziele, so Vertraulichkeit, Integrität, Verfügbarkeit, so,
Availability, Integrity and privacy. So the read to write would be about privacy, the write, that's integrity, who has the right to change the data, and execute, so the availability of this data.
In der Datensicherheit geht es aber primär, also was heißt
when it's about data security, the primary focus is the security of business processes and the available data in those processes.
Verändert werden und so weiter.
So data should be available, shouldn't be changed and so on. And since 2008, individuals have the right integrity and availability. So what about data protection or privacy?
Den Schutz personenbezogener Daten. Guckt man in die Richtung, wie wird dann das motiviert? Und dann kommt
so what's the motivation for data protection? So that's when the social component comes in.
Und dazu,
which data is being protected, how? So what the social background? We are a society. There are diverse actors who have different tasks in this society. So you don't have to sue the SOX because somebody else can do it better. Therefore, you specialize some on another task, for example.
Es gibt diverse Akteure, die miteinander irgendwie funktional interagieren.
So that's why we all interact with each other.
Interessiert mich schon, wie es dem Bäcker oder der Bäckerin gerade geht.
So maybe you are interested in how bread is done, but
und in dieser Gesellschaft gibt es dann eben auch,
so,
da sind ja nicht alle Leute, die da mitspielen, sind ja nicht gleich mächtig oder gleich fähig.
So in this society, not all people are equally powerful. There can be structural problems or organizational differences.
Organisationen, die aus vielen Menschen bestehen.
Then there are organizations that are widespread among a lot of members and
nicht gleich mächtig.
And all these actors are not equally powerful. They have their own interests. They have different opportunities and power to execute their power. If we use Max Weber, then power is the chance to execute your own will against someone else's will. Doesn't matter on what chance this is based.
Jetzt ist die Frage, okay, das ist alles noch nicht technisch.
So, this of course is not technical. What we're interested in data protection is that we have a digitization, datafication all around us, and we have information-based processing and mostly of state processes, and that results in not being able to to choose individually what to use. Like the, everyone has to use the Elster, which is a the tax paying system in Germany.
Kann man vielleicht einen Kräutertee trinken, aber wenn der Arm ab ist, dann will man vielleicht doch ein Krankenhaus. Okay, warum ist das relevant?
Okay, so why is all of this relevant? Well, all of this data processing, all of this is being used to create decisions, to make decisions. How much money can I get from the bank? What's the quickest route from A to B? What are the best friends I'm being proposed? All of these are decisions where you could have acted differently, but computer says one way and so on. And side note, all of these decisions are made on whether or not the database is correct. If it's wrong, then, well, you end up in a ditch if the route is wrong. So we're talking about data protection and information processing. Data, information, just quickly, we're still talking about definitions. So data in data protection means information models for a purpose. That's a bit simplified, but let's... If I make glasses, then the thing about a house that interests me is how many windows, which format, etc. If I am a painter, then walls interest me. So whatever I'm looking at is just a part of reality, and I'm interested in what I want to use that data for. So they're all models, representations of a part of reality for a certain purpose. So we cannot use the technical definition of data as from Shannon, you know, X kilohertz and so on and so forth. That's not what we're talking about. We're using the semiotic term of in information. And this information is made up of syntax, semantic, pragmatic, and sigmatic. Syntax being the representation in letters, semantic being the meaning in a context, pragmatic being the purpose, and sigmatic being the link to the person that is affected. So, concrete example here. We have a tuple of binary data. Oh, okay, that's geo-coordination. I mean, that was the syntax, that tuple of data. The semantic is it's geo-coordinates of a phone. The pragmatic is for providing location services. And the sigmatic is Maxi Mustafa, the person, the example person we're using here. All right, that's the situation here. That sounds kind of useful and kind of nice, but what's the problem here exactly? Well, the ever-improving technology and the data processing helps make decisions that keeps improving and being more efficient, and that helps the organizations that use it to better enforce their own interests. It's not for everyone, it's for those who use it and those who use it best. And they use it according to their own worldview and their own ideas. And that, it may be that during this information processing, the fundamental rights of people are being violated. The classic example here is biases and discrimination because of algorithms or whatever. So all of this data that is being harvested, in the worst case, completely automatically, affects people. Maybe you cannot get any more money. You've used your limit for this month. And in the first moment, you cannot do anything about it. And that's where the direct impact of this information processing on people lies. And it's not like data protection officials want to go back to before this. We all want these systems, we all want to benefit from that, but we want to minimize the negative effects that these systems have on people. And of course it helps to talk to technical people and understand how this works, and we can build better models as long as we can talk about it beforehand. But talking about concrete examples, we can say, yes, we want information processing. That's a good thing. But there are asymmetries of power, and there are violations of interests, conflicts of interest inside these organizations. And as an individual person, I cannot influence how this works, because as soon as the data leaves me, I lose control of it.
So,
a company that has tons of data on individuals can analyze it and generate data and conclusions from that that I, as an individual, cannot. And that opens different possibilities to them than I have. So the players in this situation do not have the same amount of power.
Das heißt also, wie ich es eben beschrieben habe, nur mal als Zitat nochmal von Adalbert Potlek,
dürfen keine sozialschädlichen Folgen herbeiführen. So, quoting here Adalbert Potlek, information processes may not produce socially hurting consequences. And Mr. Ross here also says the weaker person's choice of action must be preserved. And that means that we have to build software that prevents these problems. So, for example, if the software in the menu never says export, well, then you can't do it. And we have to formulate conditions for this information processing that preserve, that minimize these negative impacts.
We have to
change the conditions of this power asymmetry in our interest. Why does that have to happen? Because me, as an outsider, I cannot reprogram the systems of Amazon and whatever. My only option is to say, I don't use it at all. Or we change the conditions for this type of information processing. The question is always like, well,
das Schutzgut dabei ist eben, also Datenschutz schützt eben nicht Daten, klar, sondern Individuen.
So data protection doesn't protect the data, but the individuals. And actually, it is protecting society on a whole. So, where, of course, in the Data Protection Act of the European Union, we find these individual rights, but not the whole picture of that.
Fragen des Datenschutzes oder die Antworten des Datenschutzes und die des Datenschutzrechts, dass die nicht deckungsgleich sind.
So the questions and the answers of data protections are not the same. For explaining that a little further, that means you could draw the analogy to the cartel offices that are we have the power over the market, and that is controlled by the cartel law. We have also the power on information, and this is controlled by the data protection law.
So, möchte man nicht dabei sein, wenn sie gemacht werden. Das ist natürlich immer die Frage, was die Datenschutzdiskussion bereits auch eben seit den 60er, 70er Jahren produziert hat,
ist the law and
immer Gegenstand
the law
von
is the,
Aushandlungen, von politischen
is the result of, of the jurisdiction of the data protection. But that means that if you
weil man sich dann sehr, sehr einengt auf das, was einmal durch die
if
Politik
do,
gegangen ist.
If you do it like that, then
so, jetzt kommen wir mal ein bisschen zu einer
questions and answers are not similar.
So, zusammenzubinden.
So a bit more theory, more context. What is the flow of information? So on the left, we have the flow of information from powerful to powerless actors. Below, it's the flow of powerless to powerful actors. And we have the processes of enhancing or blocking the flow. And we want the information flow from the powerful to the powerless.
Sozusagen in dieser Informationsasymmetrie oder in dieser Machtasymmetrie geschwächt,
to reduce the power asymmetry, and that's what we call transparency. If we then block that, if the big companies, they would call it arcane practice, which means it's unclear what's happening to us as individuals. On the other hand, the information flow from the weak to the strong actors is something that we want to block. The datafication is what we want to stop, because that's what we call data protection. So from right on the top to left on the bottom, that's what we see as a problem. So when we talk to big companies, they say, oh, we don't want to tell you what we do, but we want to know everything.
And this is what's
making the powerful even more powerful. The green diagonal, that's what is empowering the weak actors. That's what people like Frag den Staat do.
Widerspruch an der Stelle. Die Frage ist nur, wer muss transparent sein?
It's actually not a contradiction, but it's the question of who is telling the rest of the world about themselves and who is not.
Für den Datenschutz und die Informationsfreiheit haben. Warum das zusammengehört? Genau deswegen gehört zusammen.
And this is why these two things are together.
Okay. Naja, warum so, aber auch Meinungen für weniger
why are there opinions of less data protection because it's expensive in terms of persons, in terms of finance, in terms of concepts? It's also hindering usage of data and information, like you would need them for some federal purposes and tasks, and for. But of course, this is true. On the other hand, for a lot of concepts, for a lot of rules that we have in our society. These are like hygiene and traffic and so on. And the rules, I mean, they are so that not one actor is using all their power to get what they want. So, what about privacy? Why didn't I use that?
Privatsphäre,
the problem with the term is if we're talking about privacy, people think about me in my own bedroom. And it's a bit Paul Müller is saying that's like living in a in the slug house. So you're encapsulated and you're not thinking about the outside. And this, that's only possible in the pre-industrial ages. Now we can't make that possible anymore. So it's not about controlling privacy completely. Because the basic human civil rights, they are affecting everyone.
Und welche Grundrechte werden berührt von dieser Datenverarbeitung?
So the idea is to make techniques social controllable. So which basic rights are concerned? It's nearly all. So like right to one owns opinion, right to free speech. So data protection is the digital dimension of all basic laws.
Da ist was Richtiges dran, aber es verengt den Blick doch radikal, worum es eigentlich geht.
To reduce this is actually also not enough. So how to operationalize this?
Wie können wir jetzt diese Ideen mit stark und schwach, wie können wir da
form demands from those categories right, strong and weak? So what are the goals of protection?
Sozusagen informationsverarbeitende Systeme müssen
so information processing systems have to pay attention to different protection goals. So this is integrity, availability, transparency, not intervenibility, privacy and not combined data. So by those categories every IT system can be analyzed.
Kann man die analysieren, ne? Nichtverkettbarkeit heißt bestimmte Informationen, die erhoben worden sind,
again, not to combine information means information or data that has been received from different goals that shall not be combined. It shall not be possible to buy them and to form a profile.
Oder eigentliche Handlungen gar nicht notwendig sind. Ne? Also das
not to collect data, which is not necessary to the actual goal of the processing.
Sozusagen übermittle oder die erhoben werden, dass sie tatsächlich
the idea is so that the individual can be sure that data which is hands over is only used for the special purpose and no more additional data is requested from myself.
Geld haben dafür, dass ich das nutzen kann und so weiter. Dann will ich natürlich auch, dass es funktioniert, weil ansonsten ist es ja ein schlechter Handel.
So of course,
Handel.
If I use something and I pay something, with, I also would like that it's using it and it shall be available. That's availability. So transparency, this other notion, is to know what is actually happening with my data, that how results are being formed. And what results are not being formed.
So
the idea of the possibility to intervene, it should be possible to say at any point of time that the operation should be stopped, the processing should be stopped. For example, if I see that there's an error, then I should be able to say stop and I would like to correct the data, for example. Or if I see that the system is discriminating, then I would like the system to be stopped and then do something to improve the system. But of course, if we are the weak, then we are not able to do something. Though that's why this is an important protection goal.
Die da für mich irgendwie Service anbieten, die ich denen gebe, da möchte ich auch sicher gehen, dass sie nirgendwo anders hingehen.
So and of course, if I hand over the data to be processed, then I want to be sure that they are kept in private with this processor and are not handed over to another processor.
Kann man sagen, na interessant. Nichtverkettbarkeit, Transparenz und Intervenierbarkeit.
So that's interesting, those three ones, not combining transparency and possibility to intervene. The green ones, they are actually summarized at under data protection. And the red ones, which I have been marked in the slide, they are actually covered by data protection, data security from the information computer
ja klar, aber der Datenschutz science. Ja, sollten diese Daten denn überhaupt da sein? Ne? Also man könnte sich so ein Zwiegespräch vorstellen.
So wo, it could be, you can imagine a discussion between a data protection officer and a data security. And the data protection officer would ask, why is the data actually there? So she is asking for the purpose. And on the other hand, the IT group, they are saying, yes, they are there, but they are really well protected. So you see the different focus of the two groups.
Dass diese Schutzziele des Datenschutzes tatsächlich auch mit dem Recht, was gesprochen worden ist, vereinbar sind.
So the different protection goals are also not in contradiction with the legislation. So,
okay, das war jetzt so der Durchritt erstmal
so
für die Grundlagen.
This was a general overview for the basics of this overall topics. So what are the non-solutions?
Okay, als erstmals der Selbstdatenschutz.
So, first off, the self-data protection, very, very, very popular, especially in connection with the blockchain, which I'll not talk about right now. Right, so we remember powerful actors, powerless actors, personal choices. What can we even do? So, how can I self-protect my data if we're talking about in organizational internal data protection? Like, how would I do that with Facebook? Do I walk in with guns, which has its own share of problems? How could I possibly do anything about that?
Oder zum Beispiel die Erinnerung, ne? Warum haben
or
wir Datenschutz?
Remember,
haben wir eben nicht,
why do we have data protection?
Weil es eine Rechts-vor-Links-Regel ist im Straßenverkehr, wo die beiden gleich stark sind. Nein, wir
because
haben
it's genau like deswegen, weil sie eben traffic where both are the same strength, but because they are differently powerful and now going to the weak and saying, well, you can protect yourself, is just cynical. That's just going to the victim and saying, well, you should just defend yourself. That makes no sense whatsoever. So now you can imagine, in this situation, when do we need data protection? When it's about credit or border or shopping or search information. That's where we need it. And like, you can imagine going to refugees at the border and saying, well, you just can do, you know, self-data protection. And so here the goal, we cannot just go and say, well, just go do it yourself. And here we have to thank, for example, Jörg Pohle, and Facebook does not have data protection settings. I mean, Facebook, insert social media here.
Welche anderen User-Daten sehen und welche anderen
but
User
what you have is settings that allow you to control how other users see and interact with your data. But there is no settings that allow you to determine how Facebook uses your data. You cannot control how long they store it or how they link your data. If you take data protection seriously, that's kind of a sticking point there.
And wenn irgendwie bei bestimmten Mobiltelefonen von Google da steht dann halt Datenschutz, wollen sie ein Backup machen. Ja, das ist aber Datenschutz, das ist nicht Datenschutz.
And so for example when in cell phones when it says, you know, data protection, you want to make a backup. Well, that's not data protection, that's data security, which is not the same thing at all. Still. Now, another non-solution is data ownership. I mean, the concept of ownership is an exclusive right to things. I have some mobile thing, a bike or whatever, or maybe even immobile stuff like a house. And I can exclusively determine what happens to that. And that's what our entire law system is based on. And if you think about data as ownership, ownership implies that things can be stolen. If data is stolen, well, is it gone? No, it's still there. It's not like a bike where if it's stolen, then you just don't have one anymore.
Das ist nicht, ne, ihr merkt an der Stelle, das ist schon vom Konzept her merkwürdig.
It's just you notice that in the abstract it's already weird. Okay, so fine, now we own our data and whatever, and we can sell our data to someone and we get something from that. And that's a huge discussion. I don't want to go there. Would it be worth €3 per month to every Facebook user to enable manipulation of elections in entire societies? What kind of trade is that? And you'll notice that something is mismatched here. Something's wrong here. And that doesn't really.
Person hätte genau von diesen drei, meinetwegen mögen es auch 30 Euro sein.
Because it doesn't really scale. Like the individual person wouldn't profit really from these three or fine 30 euros. That wouldn't change anything. And again, this would once again just support the powerful actors. It's effectively it's buying off. Something here. It's I can remain owner of my data. I don't have to give it away.
Aber wie gesagt, es ist Freikaufen. Wenn ich das Geld habe, dann bin ich darauf nicht angewiesen. Ansonsten muss ich mich quasi.
But essentially, it's buying yourself out of this. If you have the money, then you don't have to sell it. But if you need the money, well, then you just got to sell it. A classic example here is transmitting car data.
Klasse, ne? Wer geben dann keine Daten mehr raus, weiter oben. Weil klar ist,
for Mercedes cars, it's kind of like if for expensive cars, at some point, if the car is expensive enough, they don't phone home, the data doesn't leave the car anymore. And you can imagine the same thing for smart TV data. If you go to a single parent and you tell them, well, you can have this TV for €500, or you can have it for €250 if you let it sell all of your data. So if data is ownership, then who owns communication data where multiple people are involved? What do we do here? And it's entirely unclear how this would be resolved and dealt with. And equally here, you could talk about hygiene sovereignty. And you go into the kitchen and there are hygiene rules and you can check in the restaurant, is the kitchen clean enough? And how would you even tell? You have no idea what to look for. And it's just as absurd. And again, this is just the sovereignty of the stronger. Okay, so connected to this data ownership, data sovereignty idea, I called it the consent, the fetish of consent, and it relates to the fundamental right to informational self-determination. And I get asked if my data may be used for a certain purpose. And what's the problem there? So, two things. Either there's an information asymmetry or a power asymmetry. Information asymmetry means I have to consent to this thing, and next to that I have 150 pages of legalese that I have to consent to. And sure, the companies then say, well, we're just going to add some logos and simple images, and so people will understand, and then maybe we can use simple language, and we'll try really, really, really hard. And if everybody tries really, really hard and people still don't really understand, then, well, you know, this, we tried. You know, and so that puts the pressure to act back again on the individual person who has to bear this burden of being fully informed. And if you say, well, it's a power asymmetry, as I talked about before, then where you have like network effects and so on. What kind of problems arise for other people too? Like I say, I understood the end user license agreement for Google Mail, but I agreed that data from others are being shared as well, people who contact me on Google Mail.
And
right, I consented to that for everybody who interacts with me through this medium. So it's not that I didn't understand it, that I didn't have the information, but that I had somehow the power to consent for them. And there are all these dependencies and exactly the same as with the ownership question. You can consent to using the service or you can pay and then we collect less data. And if you look at this power asymmetry, then it becomes less of a question of we have to write our end-user license agreement better. It becomes a question that needs to be regulated. Some uses of information simply must not be possible.
Ganze Gesellschaften zu tun, auch Gewaltverbrechen, die aufgrund von, ne, und so weiter.
We have issues here where entire societies have had issues with violent crime based on information shared through these social networks, and that has to be dealt with. Okay, so we're getting into the final stretch. Algorithm ethics. That's a mixture of, you know, can algorithms be ethical or not? Algorithms aren't actors. Organizations are actors. You can analogously ask, is there a concrete ethics? You can ask that about anything. These algorithms have a purpose, and whose interests are being and if organizations' interests are being supported by these algorithms, then they are being used. And if you say, well, but it's an ethical question, no, not really. It's a question of responsibility, not exactly ethics. And if you say, well, yes, but these algorithms are really complicated and maybe we don't really understand and you know, artificial intelligence and so on. Well, you can ask yourself, what is it about the behavior of dogs? Well, obviously the owner of the dog is responsible. It doesn't matter why the dog did something, but somebody has to be responsible, and that's the owner of the dog. And the same is true for algorithms. So these algorithms, they don't choose purposes. They are tools to achieve a purpose. And, well, how effective applying ethics to these tools is a question that we've been dealing with since the beginning of capitalism. Okay, so now we learned about these protection goals. Can't we just apply these protection goals to all kinds of information systems? Yes, of course we can. There's a whole lot of good research to that. In Schleswig-Holstein, they did some research about that. And ultimately, it just boils down to we have to regulate that. We have to put up fences around this. And it's kind of not something we like to propose to these corporations. It's always getting somewhat problematic once we do that. And we've talked about using artificial intelligence to check this, but the problem here is that this sort of applying these sorts of ethics is sort of toothless and it doesn't really do anything. And if we really look at this datafied world, then we've already kind of moved past that. So, like, all of this discourse about ethics is interesting, but the implementation of the law is lagging behind.
Okay, das überspringen wir mal.
So that's also, we jump over.
Ben Wagner hat dazu auch neulich
so who is interested in Ben Wagner wrote about that what you can download these slides from the internet. How ethics is the new way of self-regulation, where companies say, oh yeah, we are ethical, we are regulating ourselves.
Wer sagt, mit ethischen Diskursen sollen die Unternehmen noch mal doller drüber nachdenken, was sie tun, was
but if you say that the companies should talk about that,
diese Veröffentlichung der internen E-Mails, jetzt mal
then I recommend read the publication of these internal E-Mails, because they really know what they do.
Okay,
so, conclusion.
Also,
So data protection makes organization think about the interests of the affected people when they deal out their data policies. So from their own interests, they wouldn't want to do that.
Dann auch als Betreiber solcher Systeme muss man sich immer vor Augen halten,
yourself,
die Rechte der Betroffenen, so nervig sie
providing
sein,
or,
selber Anbieterin ist, sind immer die Pflichten der Verantwortlichen. Das heißt,
or hosting something, then you have to think about the conflict of interests.
Und so weiter, dann heißt es, mir sind die Interessen und die Rechte der anderen davon egal. Und
if you don't want
so
to document that, that means
dann
you are not interested in the interests of the other.
Dann als letzter Punkt, Fokus auf personenbezogene Daten ist offensichtlich problematisch. Man kann Leute auch mit nicht personenbezogenen Daten diskriminieren.
Individual data is a problem.
Was man bräuchte, ist eine Analyse von Datenverarbeitung, die einfach
an analysis of data processing
verwendet werden. Was sind die Konsequenzen für die Betroffenen?
And what is the consequence of this data processing?
Weder hinreichend für individuelle und für gesellschaftliche Schutzfunktionen. Da müssen wir tatsächlich über diese harten Grenzen nachdenken.
And
ansonsten kommen wir dann später.
Consent is not enough for the individual nor for the protection of the society.
Angreifer ist nicht Mallory, Angreifer ist Bob, nämlich die andere Seite, die die Daten kriegt, was die damit tut.
So,
okay, danke schön.
The enemy is the one that gets the data.
He was referring to information security here, where typically it's Alice and Bob communicating and Mallory being the attacker. And he's saying that the attacker is not Mallory, not a disinterested third party, but actually Bob, the one who is communicated with.
Fragen stellen möchtet, dann könnt ihr euch an diesen Mikrofon aufstellen und.
And we are now moving. We're now moving to the question and answer portion, and. The herald is instructing people to approach the microphone and to, for anybody who leaves, that they would please leave quietly.
So thank you very much for that interesting talk. So if we have peer-to-peer systems with different power relations, where we have equal relations,
und gerade diese Peer-to-Peer-Systeme ermöglichen ja gerade diese mächtigen Datenintermediäre.
Peer-to-Peer-Systems are a way to to bypass these power relations of asymmetry. So what example then for about the small association, sports association? How should they deal about that?
Ja, gut, okay. Ist ein sehr, sehr guter Punkt, gerade diese
That's a good point. Exactly, these peer-to-peer things are... I see them as a big, big chance to distribute the data where you do not have power centers where all the data is, but you have to kind of watch out, like with Bitcoin, where it ends up being centralized after all anyway. If you manage to keep it decentralized, I have a lot of hope for this system, but that still requires a lot of research to make everything scale. But like, if we start putting even a fraction of the money we put into nuclear power into this, then I can totally see how that works. Technical point of view, I can. I think this is all surmountable, all the issues. And I think this is a path we can go. And as you walk around on Congress here, Gnutaler and so on, you can see a lot of projects where this could be applied. And the second thing is a legal question. I'll quickly talk about it. There are legal talks that go into more detail, but just quickly. And the GDPR has this risk-based approach. So if this association has this multinational global social network, then it has huge duties because of this risk. If you just keep your own membership list, then you have much smaller duties because you have to have, because the measures you take have to be appropriate to your situation. Well, maybe not a Caesar cipher, but you don't have to like have a high security system. It just has to be appropriate to the risk of the affected people.
Diese DSGVO guckt gar nicht, wie groß
so
die Organisation ist.
GDPR doesn't look at how big the organization is my answer.
Schaut aber, wie groß ist das Risiko der Betroffenen.
The GDPR does look, however, at how big is the risk to the affected people.
Die beschweren sich auch erstens, weil sie sich nicht.
So the people who complain about it, I think, are complaining because they didn't inform themselves ahead of time as they should have, but also because there is a lot of fear that is being spread around about the amount of effort that is that people will have to take.
Genau, das ist so meine Antwort. Also,
and yeah, all in all, that's just kind of my answer, and the important bit is how big are the risks for the affected? And I mean, associations, I mean, the TÜV is also an association, technically.
Sie haben jetzt für die Erklärung, was ist Datenschutz, zurückgegriffen jetzt auf die Erklärung.
So, for the explanation of what is data protection, we have used the standard data protection model. Are there different models in in scholarship, are there different discourses and?
Also das ist eine sehr gute Frage tatsächlich.
Very good question. I think this standard model of data protection is really good and it seems to hit the spot for me. There's a dissertation by Jörg Pohle who talks about the different approaches. So there are different ideas about what needs to be protected and how to go about it. And there's this big jungle, but well, my impression is that at least in the German discourse, in the European discourse, a certain school of thought is dominant, and there are different ideas which try to construct backwards from the law what the issue is and try to ask more individualized questions and calculate, so what's the risk for an individual person times the amount of people affected, and that applies, and that then lets us gauge the risk. And that doesn't work because, as we've seen, a lot of people apply consent to data processing that affects everybody else as well then, and so I think that breaks down. So in my opinion, it's very well founded
so
to choose this system.
So there is a question from the internet.
Ja, geht. Das Internet fragt, gibt es beziehungsweise kennst du eine politikerverständliche Übersicht von chaosnahen politischen Forderungen bezüglich Datenschutz und Datensicherheit mitsamt ihren Begründungen?
Of things that that people close to the Chaos Club makes wants things that they want explanations for politicians.
Well, 2 months ago, the Bits and Trees conference was in Berlin, and there was a catalog of demands which also involved data protection and data security, and the FIF was involved, and other groups, and digital other groups. And that was pretty brief and easy to understand, and that came from the context of chaos groups and chaos near groups. But I think different people and different politicians have different views on what's actually the problem. So I'm not sure that such a handout that would be comprehensible would really achieve.
Konkret zu erklären,
because I think the consensus is missing. I understand the motivation of the question, though, but my impression really is that this lack of understanding is more due to lack of courage than due to...
Wir müssen da jetzt mal harte Grenzen ziehen. Also es hat weniger mit Verständnis zu tun als mit nicht verstehen wollen. Und da hilft auch...
I don't think it's about understanding, but more about not wanting to understand. And I don't think a handout can fix that.
Und das ist so ein, also die Antworten, die notwendig wäre, die werden immer...
The answers that would be necessary become ever more clear. But I think that's a political question, and there, well, I mean, that's one of the reasons why we're here, obviously. Mikrofon 2, bitte.
Ja, ich wollte noch mal einhaken. Du hast ja gerade auch bei dem Thema Algorithmenethik.
So when you were talking about algorithm ethics, that this is the substitute debate. We don't want to talk about this, but. The other stuff, I would accept that that this is diverting on how you don't know how to deal with technology. But the problem is that they don't know what exactly they want to regulate. You have used terms like mass manipulation and election manipulation, but I think that no one in politics has any idea how to deal with that. So when they talk about bot regulation, I think that it's also complete bullshit. So what do you think, how should we deal with that? I am working in politics also, so how would you, say, algorithm ethics, that we have not understanding technology, but we still have to talk about that.
Again, that's a very interesting question. I think we need to invest some more work into turning these protection goal questions into actual questions that we can ask, and into questions like, can certain systems guarantee that our fundamental rights aren't being violated? I have a quote here about deep learning systems,
and und ich glaube,
so that sounds like a good system for sorting images, not so cool if you want to use it to analyze street images. Really concretizing what these protection goals would mean and sharing the results of that work, that would be necessary. And I think there is some good work being done. I'll have to go check later on so that the correct information gets to the right people. Some of it is already there, and I think that we could share that better.
Like,
I don't see that people are actually willing to regulate that, but if the willingness to do that were there, then we would have to make sure that these papers that do exist are shared with these people and used as guidance and applied. But that also means that certain actors would have to give away some of their power or would simply not be possible anymore. But if politicians are willing to do that, then, well, that could be done.
So I also have a question about regulation. So from a sociological perspective,
also das läuft im politischen Betrieb ganz oft über Aufrufe für Comment Letters, also das Bundesministerium für Verkehr
hat was über often we have these actions where people are writing letters to write a letter about the problem to the organization.
Genau, also wenn du dich für eine starke Regulierung aussprichst, hast du da schon irgendwie Vorstellungen, wie
man so if you think about a strong regulation, how weiterhin auch
privilegiert bleiben, selbst wenn es Regulierung gibt.
How would you want to switch off the power asymmetry in the end?
Die Königinnenfrage an der Stelle.
Well, I mean, that's the question right there, isn't it? Well, it's always about who is being asked, who has the possibilities there. Like, I understand, I've seen how depositions are made and expert questionings are done, and these corporations, they understand how they can, you know, maybe influence people.
Da wage ich mich jetzt auch ein bisschen aus dem Fenster, aber so
like I'm moving on thin ice here maybe, but like I think it's a kind of a fundamental question about how does our democracy work, and I don't think that's
von Diesel bis hin zu fange ich gar nicht erst an.
Look at the Dieselgate thing or all the other things. This is not a question about data protection, it's a democracy question. And there's a lot of ideas from lobbying registration to lots of ideas. Maybe we should all of us involved in these digital law questions should think about long-lasting solutions. Maybe we should just all like invest like 10% of what we have in like lobby control or similar efforts to
Digitalrat, KI Enquete und so weiter,
wie gesetzt sind. Klar, wenn ich to affect how these commissions and
dass ich dann diese Antwort kriege. Also das ist jetzt so ein bisschen so eine Frage, wie kriege ich mehr Leute aus der Wissenschaft?
Councils are set up and like
das ist vielleicht eine nicht so hilfreiche Antwort.
And get the right people involved there. That's a difficult question. I'm sorry, I don't have anything better to say, but it's a democracy question. And I mean, that's frankly why it should interest us, right? All our work, a lot of our work may be for nothing because this broken system just eats it again.
So I see that the discussion is burning. Unfortunately, we are running out of time. So this is where you find me, this email address or at the fifth association here on the CCC.
Dann findet man mich da. Dankeschön.
Genau.
So thank you very much.